Hello, hello, welcome. My name is Obinaku. Welcome. Today I want to share with you mistakes people make in investing in real estate in Ghana. Mistakes people make in investing in real estate in Ghana. I'm not talking about building for yourself. I'm talking about trying to build to get some level of income. You know, building as an investment. I don't think so much that the one that you built for yourself, the 10 bedroom that you built for yourself in a nice location in Accra, which you live in, that does not bring any income, is an investment so much that is able to add value to your wealth or to bring some kind of money to you, unless you built it and you rented it. I mean, if you built it and you rented it, then I think you are on the path to making it an investment. But building a house like the one that I live in, I don't take any rent from it, you know. So I just live in, and maybe I'm not paying, rent to anybody, which is a good thing. But really, it's not bringing much value. What it does is that it makes you feel good that, you know, people will say that, you know, you are not a poor man. You live in your own house. It's just something that massages our ego, but it's not a tool to creating wealth. So I'm talking about investing, some of the mistakes that people make in investing in properties as a tool to creating some level of wealth. You know, so if you come in Ghana, for instance, this is kind of some of the stories that are here, the pain points that people get in terms of trying to invest. As a matter of fact, not many people invest. Most people build for themselves. They build only to live in, you know, they build for themselves. And some people can build 3 to 5 houses, you know, that's fine. But if you want, because the real estate is the tool, it's about the most convenient and safest tool of wealth preservation. If you want to preserve wealth for the generations, for those after you and for those after you, there's no other place better than investing in lands, in properties, in buildings. You know, my grandfather's cocoa farm is still there. The family owns the land, you know, so it can be there for centuries until somebody else messes up. So it's a good thing. So you can invest in land, but the mistakes people make is that sometimes, especially in a key area like Accra mainly, there are a lot of issues. So you should do your due diligence. Do your due diligence very well, and as we know it, from my experience, deal with people who have been doing this, and deal with people who are credible, people you can trust their word. Build that trust before somebody else just takes you to say, oh, there's a land here, let's go and check, you know. And most often take the land documents and also, you know, do your some bit of but the safest is the character of the individual that you're dealing with, because even if there is a problem, that person will not run away. They will stay with you till you are through with whatever challenges that you meet. And so do your due diligence well, and go to the place when it is raining as well to see if the place is safe and is secure. The other mistake that people do is they go to take bank loans to build for rent. If you're taking the loan from Ghana, you should make sure that the loan is no more than 10% a year. And I don't think we have that in terms of city. So I will not do that. Most often, the people that I've seen who have tried to build a real estate business, invest in the real estate, and gotten into a lot of troubles were people who were running with loan. People who went for high interest loan and then trying to build a house, because you're going to use, let's say, 6 months, 1 year, 2 years to build that house, and they are not going to stop that interest from, you know, accruing. So the interest will be there by the time that you finish that house. Let's say you went to take 200,000, the interest, they are charging 30% a year. So by the time you finish building that house, 2 years is gone, that's 60%, and maybe another year to sell that house. That's almost 100%. So now the 200,000 has become 400,000. How much are you going to sell in that house? To sell that house. Now that becomes a headache for you. And another thing that I see that becomes a bit of challenge to most people is where they cite their concept. You know, the concept, you are building a house in an area that most people cannot afford the rent, and yet you are building and finishing it in a super quality form. And when you finish, you say that you're renting at 5,000 for 2-bedroom house in an area that those who can afford that will not prefer to live, you know. So then you miss it. So that your concept must fit the location that you have, your concept, your pricing, the finishing, the whether it's an apartment, what kind of apartment, whether you are building one, you know, single room, self-contained, two bedroom, three bedroom, what kind of house are you building? Does it fit the people that you are trying to build for? You must have the people that you are trying to build for in mind, and you must have the kind of money that they can use to rent. You know, most often you are using about a third of your salary for rent. Let's face it, a third of your salary. So if I'm taking 1,000, I'm probably renting around 200 or 300 Ghana cedis. And so if your rent is 1,000, I'm taking 1,000, and you want to take 1,000, that one will not work. So it could be a mistake in terms of your concept and where you're situating your concept. And that's why sometimes you can see people have built houses they have put there for rent and nobody's going there. It's not because people don't like it, but the pricing is way beyond most people who live in that locality. You know, so that could be a mistake. And the other thing is a wrong construction team. That's a pain point as well for most people. You know, most people, construction is a very technical field. You may think that is that easy, it's not that easy. And any mistake that you make is cost. You know, you are building it, is a mistake, it's cost. And when you're breaking it, it's a cost. You pay the labor for pay for labor before they break it, and then when you're rebuilding it, it's the same. You pay for material and you pay for labor, and there is also time component. So your best advantage will be the kind of team that you're able to put together. Most people have gone through a lot of terrible experiences trying to invest in real estate, because we don't build a lot of houses that we don't have a lot of contractors or investors building houses, let's say apartment for instance, and then selling them where people can buy them and rent them themselves. We don't have so many of that. So in our market, you have to design and build yourself, and then you rent. So you probably are just the investor, the developer, and then maybe even the financier most of it, which means that you must have a very strong construction team to work with, whether you're putting that team together yourself or you're getting a contractor to it for you. But your pain will come from the kind of people you put together. I will go for two things, their expertise and their honesty. I'll go for those, their expertise and their honesty. If you shorten on one, I have to balance it. But a lot of the times I will compromise a little on the expertise and go for somebody who'll be a bit straightforward. Because then if he buys 10 bags of cement, it's 10 bags of cement. He's not buying 20 and telling me it's 10. If 10 people came to work, he's giving me 10 people, not 50. You know, because then you build beyond your strength. You budgeted 200,000 for this building. If you don't have very honest people building for you, you end up spending 400,000. Or even if you spend the 200,000, the quality has been compromised, which means that you may be still within budget, but the quality that you paid for may be 100,000. You know, so I will establish credibility before technical expertise. Technical expertise can also save you a lot of money, because if they know the processes and if they know what they're doing and the concept is good, you get a good product, you meet your timelines, and then you do it with a little bit of ease. But you look for honesty. I from my experience, somebody who has very good character and good social skills, because it's a problem. Construction is a problem that you're solving. Once you see it on the drawing, you're going to produce that physically. It's a problem. Every day there's a problem somewhere. And so you want somebody who has very good problem solving skills. You have somebody who is mature emotionally, who is not erratic, who is not, you know, proactive, who is able to hold disagreements, and who is able to keep their composure, and who is able to take stress, and who is able to pull people. And so your best bet will be the person that you give the project to, the one who's leading the project, how honest they are and how fluent they are in terms of explaining things to you for you to understand. And never stay out of the concept. Be involved, especially when it gets to the finishing. Be involved when you get to the when you're buying the tiles, the fittings, the kitchen design, the doors, you know, the ceilings, the ACs, all those. Be involved in terms of the quality. Don't just, if you leave it with them, a lot of the times they will buy it according to their exposure. And so if they are not that much exposed, then they, even if they are honest, what they will put there, you may not like it. Maybe the paint, the tiles design, the tile color, all those. Not just the quality, the design. maybe you like white and they like brown. You know, so sometimes, because once they fix it, if you want to remove it, it's a problem. You know, because then you have to spend more. So be involved in a lot of things like that. So that, because it's your property, you know, and you are going to rent it and get your money, and you every waste goes against you. Every waste goes against you. So you would want to be involved so that at least you can manage the waste and you know, be able to come out with something that you are proud of. Even if it is not, but there is no structure, there's no building, there's no project that when you finish everything is perfect. You're just trying to say that, you know, the things that are not so much, you know, they're not going to cause engineering or technical problem to the structure. At least it may be something that hurts your ego, that you may not have put this thing there if you paid a little more attention. You know, that's okay. But for a technical problem, you know, then that, you know, maybe when you finish the pipes are off or electrical problems everywhere, or maybe the ceiling, the roofing is leaking, something. Well, maybe even the whole building is not even stable. There are cracks everywhere. You want to be, you know, you want to get the best of engineers, the best of foremen, the best of people who, and go and look at what they have done. If the first time engaging them, go and look at what they have done, what they have produced. And a lot of the times you look at the taste they have. Because sometimes when you are going through town, you see some buildings, you see the wood, how they have cast the concrete, you know that this one, they overlook a lot of things. And therefore, for me, I mean, the quality of a building, I look at some of the way the site is being managed, the way a lot of things, I mean, they go to prove the quality that you're going to get at the end of the day. You know, so you don't want people who just say, oh, mass away, they're saying, yeah, hey, you know, those kind of things will eventually, because you don't really save much. It's like water. You know, you put water somewhere in a building, it will find its way out. So anything that you are trying to cut corners, compromise, they will find their way out somewhere. So that's why people will finish their house within 2 years.